Hello everyone. In the previous video, we had discussed about the aggregate analysis of the amortized analysis. In today's video, we are going to discuss the second method by name accounting method. Now, before discussing accounting method, let me take one more example for aggregate analysis, and we'll use the same example for the accounting method. Now, the third example that I have taken for aggregate analysis is a binary counter. I have taken an example for a 2-bit binary counter, wherein, okay, this is my 2-bit binary counter, wherein initially I have the counter value as 0, next, okay, I am having it as 1, 2 and 3. Now, in case of the binary counter, rather than stating it as a 2-bit binary counter, let me call it as a k-bit binary counter. The most common operation that we can perform in case of any k-bit counter is the increment, decrement and the reset operation. Now, what do you mean by increment operation? In case of increment operation, increment on a counter adds a bit 1 to the current value of the counter. Say for example, if my current value is 001101, I need to add 1 to this so that my answer becomes 001110. That is the meaning of the increment operation. Now, the reverse of this increment operation is the decrement operation, wherein in case of decrement operation, the decrement on a counter subtracts a bit 1 to the current value of the counter. Say for example, if my current value is 00110, on subtracting 1 on this particular value, I get 001101. So, this is the second operation by name decrement. The third operation I can state it as reset, wherein in case of reset, all the bits becomes 0. Now, what we will do in order to understand what you mean by aggregate analysis on the on a binary counter, let me take only the operation increment. I'll just consider this increment operation. Now, if you see, okay, in case of this 2-bit counter, this is an increment operation. 0 becomes 1 on adding bit 1. 1 becomes 2 on adding bit 1. Bit 2 becomes 3 on adding byte 1. That means on every addition of bit 1, 0 gets changes to 1, 1 gets changes to 2, 2 gets changes to 3. Now, in case of the regular analysis, what we do, that is, on this, what is the worst case scenario? The worst case time complexity of the increment operation. Now, in case of increment operation, what is the basic operation? Basic operation is nothing but one of the bit gets flipped from 0 to 1, or it may get flipped from 1 to 0. Now, worst case scenario of the increment operation, if you see that in this example, this 00 will become 11. It will both the two bits will be flipped. So I can say in a k-bit counter, the worst case scenario is order of k, where k is the number of bits. So n such increment operation, what is the time of n such increment operation? N increment operation has the time complexity as order of nk. Now, the time for each operation, each increment operation is order of k, and n such increment operation has a time of nk. Now, what we are supposed to prove in case of amortized analysis is the amortized cost or the average cost is not order of k. I should prove that the amortized cost or the average cost is order of 1. That is what we are supposed to prove here. Now, what we'll do, rather than taking an example for a 2-bit counter, let me take an example for the 8-bit counter. Yeah, let us consider 8 bits denoted with A0 to A7. Let me take this as A0, this as A1. A2, A3, A4, A5, A6 and A7. Now, if you note this in this counter, what you can observe is, it is not that all the 8 bits will be flipped. Nowhere in this you find that all the 8 bits are being flipped from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. Now, what is the observation that you can make out is, bit E of 0 is flipped alternatively. If you see, it is 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 and 0. In the sense, I can say E of 0, that is bit E of 0 flips every time. It flips every time. In the sense, 0 is flipped to 1, 1 is flipped to 0, 0 is flipped to 1. In each iteration, bit E of 0 flips every time. Now, what about E of 1? E of 1 is this. So, if you see 0, 0, in the first and the second iteration, it is not flipped. Third and fourth iteration, it is flipped. Fifth and sixth iteration, it is not flipped. Next, in the next two iteration, it has been flipped. That is, E of 1 flips. You can note, E of 1 flips every other time. It flips every other time. That is, it flips N by 2 times. I can say, it flips N by 2 times. Now, what about E of 2? E of 2 flips. E of 2 flips every... See here, this is four zeros followed by four ones. 4 0 followed by four ones. E of 2 flips every fourth time. That is, it flips N by 4 times. N by 4 times. Similarly, E of 3. In general, I can say bit E of I flips. How many times? It flips every 2 by I times, that is N by 2 power I times. N by 2 power I times. That is, one more observation that you can do is, for I is equal to 0, 1, 2, up to log N. Up to log N, bit E of I flips. Flips N by 2 power I times. It flips N by 2 power I times. But for I greater than log N, take the floor. For I greater than log N, bit E of I never flips. Now, if you see in this case, for I greater than log n, if I take n as 16, log n is 16 base 2 is 4. For I greater than 4, for i greater than 4, that is 4, 5, 6 and 7, if you see, for first 15 values, it never flips at all. That is the meaning of for i greater than log n, bit E of I never flips. Coming to the total cost of performing n increment operation is, for n increment operations, the time is summation of I is equal to 0 up to log n of n by 2 power I. This is less than summation of I is equal to 0 to infinity of n by 2 power I. Now, if you take n outside, this will be n summation of I is equal to 0 to infinity of 1 by 2 power I. Now, what is this value? Summation of 0 to infinity 1 by 2i is equal to 2, which is nothing but less than or equal to 2n. That is nothing but order of n. That is the cost of performing n increment operation is order of n. Now, what is the cost of performing one operation? Therefore, cost of one operation is order of n by n, which is nothing but order of 1. So, this is the average cost of the amortized cost. Hope this is clear. This was about how to do aggregate analysis on performing n increment operation on a bit counter, k bit counter. Let's see the next topic. The next topic is about the accounting method. First, we'll see what do you mean by accounting method, and we'll use the same three examples that we have used earlier to explain the concept of accounting method. Yeah, coming to the accounting method. In case of accounting method, we need to charge for a particular operation. If say, for example, if there is only one operation, we need to charge something for that particular operation. In case if there are multiple operations, like the example that we took in case of a stack, we need to charge something for push operation. We need to charge something for the pop and the multi-pop operation. Note that if there are multiple operations, then it is not necessary that all the operations should be charged the same cost. That is what mentioned here. In accounting method, we assign different charges for different operation. Even in some cases, some of the operation may not be charged at all. Note that, okay, the amount we charge in case of accounting method is called as the amortized cost. Let me denote CI as the actual cost and CI dash as the amortized cost. Note that the amortized cost should always be greater than or equal to the actual cost. Now, in case of the amortized cost, what we do is we charge some extra, extra dollar for each of the operation, so that it can be stored and it can be used later. Now, something like what I can say, in case of accounting method, we need to put ourselves in the position as an accountant. That means for each operation that we do, we need to charge something. We may charge extra also, and those extra things that we are charging can be stored. Let me call that stored thing as bank. Say for example, once the credit is nothing but the extra that we are charging, the amortized cost minus the actual cost. Note that the credit of our bank should never go to negative. That is what we should do. That means we should charge in such a way for each of the operation that our bank never goes for the negative balance. That means the credit should always be greater than or equal to zero. Why it should be always greater than or equal to zero? Whatever amount is left out in the bank can be used for later operation. As I told that there might be some free operation out of the n operation that I am performing. So this is the introduction about the accounting method. Now let us apply this accounting method for the dynamic hash table example that we have considered in case of the aggregate analysis. Coming to the example of dynamic tables using the accounting method, note that in case of dynamic table, my operation is insertion operation. Now, I should come up with how much should I charge for the insertion operation. That means here, what should be the cost of insertion? How much dollar do I need to change? How much rupees do I need to charge in order to insert an element onto the table? Now, if you see, this was the basic things. That means I is the element to be inserted, ranging from 1 to n. Size denotes the size of my hash table. If I want to insert one, at that time, the hash table was having one slot. If I want to insert two, hash table size was having size as 2, and to insert 3, 4, this was the table size got double, from 1 to 2, from 2 to 4, from 4 to 8, from 8 to 16, from 16 to 32, and so on. Now, what is the actual cost? Actual cost is denoted with CI. You might have noted that the actual cost CI is equal to I, if I minus 1 is the integral multiple of 2, or it is 1 otherwise. So, if you see, there are so many 1s apart from 2, 3, 5 and 9. Because 2 minus 1 is 1, which is 2 power 0. 3 minus 1 is 2 power 1, 5 minus 1 is a 2 square, and 9 minus 1 is a 2 cube. So, if you have split the C of I as all n's plus some extra thing. Now, question comes, what should be the cost of insertion operation? I'll assume that if I charge only $1, what happens? Please note that here, the insertion operation, whenever we come across overflow, what we need to do for overflow, we need to double the size of the hash table. And whenever we double the size of the hash table, the old keys which were stored in the hash table needs to be copied to the new table also. Please note that while charging something for the insertion operation, we should make sure that there should be some amount left out in order to copy the old items or old key into the new table. Now let me assume that if I am charging only $1 for each insertion operation. Now what happens is when I am charging only $1 for all the insertion operation. Now the actual cost is 1. Now, how much is left out in the bank? Because I am charging only $1, nothing is left out. So, left out is $0. Now, next, in order to insert 2, as the hash table was full, I need to resize the hash table. And if you see, initially I am moving 1 to the new table, as well as I need to copy 2 to the new table also. In the sense, I need to insert 1 as well as I need to insert 2. Now, how much I require? Actually, the actual cost required is 2, but how much I am charging? I am charging only $1. If I am charging $1, what is the shortage? Shortage is $1. So, the shortage is $1. So, I came across negative. So, if I charge only $1 for the insertion operation, it is not sufficient. $1 is ruled out. Now, coming to $2. Assume that I am charging $2 for each insertion operation. Initially, I am charging $2 to insert 1. So, to insert 1 onto hash table, $1 is being used. A stands for actual, R stands for remaining. 1 is remaining. Now, to insert 2, I am charging $2. But for inserting 2, I require $2. Because 1 to copy the first element to the new table and the second element. I required 2. Remaining was 1. So, 2 plus 1 was 3. How much left out? Left out is 1. Now, coming to the third element. Now, coming to insert 3. If you see, while inserting 3 also, we came across overflow. So, I need to double the size of the hash table. I need to copy 1 and 2 to the new table, and 3 needs to be copied. What is the actual cost? Actual cost is 3. If you see, actual cost is 3. Now, how much was remaining in the earlier one? Earlier one, $1 was remaining. And the new cost is $2. $2 plus $1 is $3. So, I have utilized all $3. So, remaining is 0. Next, going to the inserting 4. How much cost is required for inserting 4? 1 is required. I am charging $2. So, left out is $1. Fine. Now, to insert 4 also, it is fine. Now, to insert 5. What is the actual cost? Actual cost is $5. How much is left out? Left out in the bank is $1. And the new cost of insertion is $2. 1 plus 2 is 3. 3 minus 5 is minus 2. So, I came across a negative. So, even if I charge $2 also for each insertion operation, it is not possible. Now, let's take, if I am charging $3, what happens? I am charging $3 for first insertion, actual cost is 1, remaining is 2. Next insertion, I have 3 more dollars. So, 2 plus 3 is 5. For out of 5, 2 is required for the actual and 3 is remaining. Now, in the next insertion operation, I use 3 more dollars. So, total is $6. Out of $6, 3 is being used. 3 is being used for the insertion operation. And 3 plus 3 is 6. I am left out with 3. Next insertion operation, 3 plus 3 was 3 plus 3 was 6. Out of 6, I require only 1. I require only 1. So left out is 5. Left out is 5. So in the next insertion operation, 5 plus 3, 8. Out of 8, how much I require for the actual insertion? 5. So out of 8, 3 is 5 is used. 5 is used and left out is 3. So if you continue, you will see that $3 is more than sufficient for inserting an element onto a dynamic hash table. But there is a special case. You can note that there is a special case that first time we can charge only $2. And for remaining other things we can charge, and for remaining we can charge $3. That means only for this first insertion operation, rather than charging $3, I can charge only $2, and all the other remaining insertion operation, $3 is fine. If you trace this, you will find that the bank balance will never go for negative. So this was about what do you mean by accounting method with respect to the dynamic table. Coming to the accounting method of the k-bit counter. Now this was the example that we have considered, and we have assumed that we have performed n insertion operation on this particular counter. Now if you see the total cost, is maybe for the counter value 0, there are no, all bits have been initialized to 0, hence the total cost is 0. Next counter value 1 is being switched to, this 0 is being switched to 1, hence the cost is 1. In the next iteration, this 1 is switched to 0 and this 0 is switched to 2. So I require, there are 2 flips. So if I add 2 to this 1, it becomes 3. In the next iteration, if you see, only 1 bit is being achieved. This is 0, this. Now in the next iteration, if you see, only 1 bit is being changed. From 0 it is being changed to 1. 1 remains as it is. So from 3 it becomes to 4. In the next iteration, if you see, all these 3 bits are being changed. 1 is being flipped to 0, this 1 is flipped to 0, and this 0 is being flipped to 1. Hence it is 4 plus 3, 7, and so on. This is the total cost. As we know, in case of accounting method, we need to assign some cost for the operation, and the operation that we have considered here is only the increment operation. Note that for each increment operation we will assign $2. Now $2 or 2 rupees, it doesn't matter. As we have defined that in case of the accounting method, we need to charge some cost for each of the operation. And finally, we should make sure that the total cost, that means whatever is left out after performing the operation, it should never go for the negative value, as we have discussed in case of the dynamic table. The same rules applies here also. Now, here, we need to, as the operation that we are considering is only the increment operation, we will assign for each increment operation $2. Now why $2? Why $2? $1 for flipping 0 to 1. $1 is being flipped for flipping 0 to 1, and other $1 and remaining $1 is stored. Why? Because later when this one has to be flipped back to zero, we will use that particular dollar. Please note that for the increment operation, in case of a counter, we should charge $2. Let's see. Okay, what happens? Okay, if we charge $2 for this particular counter. Now, for zero. Now, if you see here, this 0 has to be flipped to 1. Now how many dollars I need to charge? I need to charge $2. Charge for all operation. If you see, the charge for all this operation are $2. $2. I'll stop here itself so that okay, the same thing continues. Now out of this $2, out of this $2, how much is actually charged? Actual charge is $1. Out of $2, $1 is being charged to flip 0 to 1. How much is remaining? Remaining is $1. Now coming to the second one. this $1, I need to charge $2 here once again. So one is flipped to zero. So for flipping this one to zero, I'm not charging anything. Okay, that means for $1 is charged from flipping to zero to one, and remaining $1 is stored. $1 is stored as it is. The $1 that is being stored is being used to flip 1 to 0, but to flip 0 to 1, I am charging once again $2. That is, for every increment operation, I am charging $2. Now, what is the actual cost here? The actual cost is $1 to flip this 0 to 1, and $1 which was there earlier is being used to flip 1 to 0. $2 is used and $1 is remaining. Next, for this operation. Now, to flip 0 to 1, I am charging $1. And remaining $2 is being... actually, the charge I am doing is $2. Remaining is 1. There are $3 left out. Now, out of $3, $1 is being used to flip from 0 to 1. And this 1 and 1 remains as it is. So, out of the $3, I am using only $1. And $2 is being remaining as it is. Next iteration, I am charging $2 more. 2 plus 2, $4. Out of those $4, $2 are being used to flip 0 to 1 to 0, and $1 is being used to flip 0 to 1. So how much dollar is used? Out of $4, $3 is used and $1 is remaining. If you continue the same thing, you will see that the bank balance will never go for the negative thing. That is what we are supposed to do. In case of accounting method, we need to come up with how much amount of charge needs to be done for each of the dollar. As in this case, there is only one operation, that is the increment operation. I am charging only for increment operation. As what we saw in case of the other example, maybe we will see the other example of performing push, pop and multi-pop operation on a stack, wherein we charge only for push operation, but we don't charge anything for pop and multi-pop operation. Hope this is clear. This is about the accounting method for the binary counter. Yeah, coming to the example of the stack, in case of the accounting method, as we have discussed in case of the stack example in the aggregate analysis, in case of stack, we were allowed to perform three operations. One was push, the second was pop, and the third one was the multi-pop operation. Here, we have three different operations as compared to the single operation of insertion in case of dynamic table, wherein we charged $3. Here, we are having three operations. Note that out of this three operation, some operation might be free and some operation might be charged. In the sense, as I told earlier in the beginning, that in case of accounting method, all the operations are not necessarily that it should be charged the same cost. We might charge some value for push operation, we might charge some other value for pop operation, and some charges for the multi-pop operation. Now question comes, what should be the charge for each of the operation? So, in case of push, let me assume that we charge $2. $1 is actually for actual push, and $1 is stored. Why $1 is stored? Because the element which we are pushing onto stack will be performed a pop operation, either with the help of pop or with the help of multi-pop operation. So, we charge $2 for the push operation. If I charge $1 for push operation, what happens? If I charge only $1 for push operation, then the pushing happens, but there will be nothing left out in the bank. So, please note that in order to perform the push operation, we can charge $2. And what will be the charge for pop operation? We will not charge anything for pop operation. Pop operation is $0. Now similarly, what about multi-pop operation? Multi-pop operation is also $0 because we don't charge anything, because we have already stored some amount while performing the push operation. The same amount will be used for performing the pop and multi-pop operation. So if I charge $2 for push and no charges for pop and multi-pop operation, we can easily perform the series of push and push pop and multi-pop operation. Say for example, this is my push, second one is push, third one is pop, fourth one is push, fifth one is multi-pop, and so on. Now, for this push operation, how much I am charging? I am charging $2. Now, out of this $2, one is used for push, and how much is remaining? One is remaining. Now, for this push operation, how much I am charging? I am charging $2. One I am pushing. One I am using it to push onto the stack. One will be remaining. This one will be added with the previous one. Previously, while pushing the first element, I was having $1. Now, while pushing the second element, I have $1 more left out. So, $2 is left out. Now, how much I charge for pop? Pop is $0. I don't charge anything. But whenever I pop, the $2 which is already stored in the stack among those two elements will be utilized. So, actual is I don't charge anything for this pop operation, but how much is left out? Left out is zero now, because those $2 are being used to pop the, sorry, this is just pop. Pop is only one element. Only one element will be popped from the stack. So $1 will be stored. Now, if I perform push once again, how much I am charging? I am charging $2. Out of two, one is being used for push and one is will be remaining. That one gets added here too. Now, if I perform multi-pop, note that multi-pop is nothing but it will pop k elements or it will pop n elements from the stack. If you are popping all the elements from the stack, the number of elements left out in your stack is 2. So, this multi-pop operation is 0 charge, but it will utilize this 2 that was there. All this 2 is been utilized. Now, you are left out with 0. If you note, this balance or this credit never goes to negative. So, this is about the accounting method. This is about the accounting method. I'll rewrite once again. Cost of push for this example is $2, which is nothing but order of 1. This is a constant. Similarly, cost of pop is how much? It is $0, which is nothing but order of 1. Similarly, cost of multi-pop is $0. It is nothing but order. Note the difference between aggregate analysis and accounting method. In case of aggregate analysis, all operations were charged same value. But whereas in case of accounting method, it is not necessary that all charges should be charged the same rate. And there might be some free operations also. Hope this is clear. Thank you.